Namaste everyone. It's a privilege to have Professor Pavan Kumar Singh from IIM Indore for this module. He is a professor in the area of OB and HRM with a teaching experience of about 3 decades. He has taught at NITI Mumbai, IGNU New Delhi, Kanpur University and Vikram University, Ujjain. Before joining academic career, he has worked with Bank of India as Industrial Relations Officer. His teaching training, research and consulting interests are on themes related to OB, HRM, human values and Indian ethos. Today, we will have discussion with him on managerial insights from Sanskrit scriptures. Sir, why Sanskrit scriptures should be referred for managerial solutions?
Well, many of us might think that Sanskrit scriptures are too old and managerial problems are pertaining to present time. But let me submit very humbly that scriptures, they have time-tested golden sutras, which if interpreted properly, they are capable of providing solutions for modern problems. You see, like we keep changing annual calendars every year from the wall, but scriptures are not like annual calendars. They are like mirrors. More you get matured, and when you see your face in the mirror, more matured face you see. So mirror, we do not complain any time that mirror has become old. Similarly, because scriptures have been mostly written by, especially Shruti and also Smritis, by those persons who have first of all worked very deeply to cleanse their psyche. They have come from pure thoughts, pure minds, and that's why scriptures, they have perennial applications even for today's problem. I'll just quote something from scriptures, and just you see on the screen the first quote in favor of scriptures. Brahma Vidya Upanishad Shloka 32 says, Shrutya Virodhe Na Bhaved Pramanam Bhaved Anarthaya Vina Pramanam. It means no proposition can be against the dictates of scriptures. What is not a right proposition would be calamitous. See another sutra in favor of scriptures. Bhagavad Gita 16th chapter shloka number 23 and 24. Yah shastra vidhi mutsrijya vartate kamakaratah nasa siddhim vapnoti na sukhang na param gatim tasmat shastrang pramanante karya kare vyavasthitau gyatva shastra vidhanoktang karma kartumiharhasi. It means having cast aside the injunctions of the scripture, he who acts in an arbitrary way according to his own sweet will neither attains perfection nor the supreme goal nor even happiness. Therefore, the scripture alone is your guide in determining what should be done and what should not be done. Knowing this, you ought to perform only such actions as is ordained by the scriptures. So we can see that various scriptures themselves have talked in the favor of scriptures. I'll quote another scripture dictate here in Yog Vasishtha chapter number 5 and sub part 4/5 says, Apurv Ahlad Adinya Uchay Starpadashrayah Ati Mohapaharanya Suktayohi Mahi Asam. It means maxims, it means scriptures of great persons provide immense bliss, lead to supreme state and remove completely the infatuation within. Let us see other support in favor of scriptures. Narad Bhakti Sutra, Sutra number 12 and 13 narrate, Bhavatu Nishchay Dardhya Durdhvang Shastra Rakshanam Anyatha Patitya Shankaya. It means even after strong determination of following the path of self-realization, scriptures should be protected. One should follow scriptures, otherwise there is possibility of downfall. Let us see some more supports in favor of scriptures. Shukraniti. Shukraniti was written by Shukracharya, who was guru of demons and very learned personality. And he says in chapter number 1, sutra 50, Shastratah sad sajgyatva tyaktva sat asat samacharet. It means after knowing about the virtuous acts and wise acts through the scriptures, one should shun the vice acts and should adopt the virtuous acts. In this way, we can go on and on. I have few more to support scriptures through sutras, and this one again comes from Shukraniti. Na hankaro cha dharmandha shastranang tattva chintanayah ekang shastra madhiyano na vindyat kare nirnayam syad ahvagam sandarshi vyavaharo mahanatah buddhimanabhyasein nityang bahu shastranya tandritah. It means, after pondering over many scriptures, one should not be attached to egoism and fanaticism. After reading only one scripture, one should not decide upon an action or about the truth, because he only is knower of vast worldly behaviors who has read many scriptures thoroughly. So a wise person should read many scriptures without subjecting himself to slothfulness. In this way, we find various supports in favor of scriptures. I'll quote once again Chanakya Sutra, Shloka number 300, Indriyanang Prashmang Shastram. It means the very energy of keeping the senses poised is a scripture. Let us have some more. Chanakya Niti says, Sansar Katu Vrikshasya Dve Falehya Mritopame Subhashit Rasas Swadah Sangateh Sujanayah Sah. It means, of the bitter tree of the world, there are two sweet fruits. One is the taste of maxims, and the other is companionship of the nobles. Ramayana by Valmiki in Aranyakanda says, 50th chapter, 22nd shloka, Hetu bhirnyaya sanyuktair dhruvang ved shruti mivah. It means, no one on the basis of his own convenient logic can turn aside the quintessential issues of scriptures, which have been tested against parameters of justice and truth. Now let us have some quotations from the biggest book of the world, Mahabharata, Adi Parva, chapter 1, 244 shloka. This says, Yeshang Shastranuga Buddhirna Te Muhyanti. It means, whose intellect follows the scriptures are never subjected to infatuation. So, we can go on and on. There are many supports in favor of scriptures. Let me submit very humbly that scriptures are time-tested piece of wisdom.
Sir, what are the main scriptures you would like to refer to?
There are plethora of scriptures, many scriptures. Broadly, they have been divided into two parts. One is called Shruti and other part called Smriti. In Shruti, the main point pertains to introduction to self, who I am, what is my real worth, what is my real configuration. Whereas Smritis, they talk about how we should behave ourselves in society, in organization, and how we can be more dedicated to various responsibilities towards nation and towards ecology. Let me tell you that some scriptures academicians from the field of management should also refer. I would like to place some of them before you. You can see on the screen. There are four Vedas: Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sam Veda, and Atharv Veda. There are six Vedangas. They are Siksha, Kalpa, Vyakaran, Nirukt, Chand, and Jyotish. Vedanga are those pieces of literature which must be read before we read Veda, because they are very important to understand Vedas properly. Other scriptures, Upanishads. Other set of piece of knowledge is Prasthana Trayi. Prasthana means to move from one point to another, from ignorance to light. And Trayi means three. And Prasthana Trayi contains three set of books. One set comprises the entire Upanishads. The other set is Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavad Gita. And third one is Brahma Sutra by Ved Vyas. Then we have Shad Darshanam. Shad means here six. There are six basic pillars of Indian school of psychophilosophy. And they are, again, number one, set of all Upanishads. Second, Yoga Sutra by Patanjali. Third, Sankhya by Kapil. Fourth, Nyaya by Gautam. Fifth, Vaisheshik by Kanad. And sixth, Mimamsa by Jaimini. There are other books of supreme knowledge. This is my way of categorization. And this set includes Yog Vasishtha, where Guru Vasishtha talks about highest piece of wisdom to his disciple Lord Ram. Other book is Ashtavakra Gita, where Ashtavakra talks to Janaka. Janak is the receiver and Ashtavakra is the giver. And when receiver himself is a person of very highest wisdom, you can easily understand the profundity of this text, Ashtavakra Gita. And third one in this category is Shiv Sutra, which is dialogue between Lord Shiv and Goddess Parvati. And Shiv shares again various methods of meditation and especially Tantra to Goddess Parvati. Other books are Bhakti Sutras, and there are two Bhakti Sutras which are very prominent. One is called Narad Bhakti Sutra and other is Shandilya Bhakti Sutra. See on the screen again, please, and you will find other scriptures. There are 23 Smritis available, but three are more popularly known and they should be referred to, like Manu Smriti, Yajnavalkya Smriti and Parashara Smriti. Then there are books on Niti, Shukra Niti, Bhartrihari Shatak Tray and Chanakya Niti. In Shukra Niti, we find very important and pertinent knowledge about various functional areas of management, including financial management, human resource management. Bhartrihari Niti Shatak has been trifurcated into three parts. First is called Shringar Shatak, second is Niti Shatak, and third is Vairagya Shatak. And the chapters themselves suggest about the right direction of journey in the life. And Chanakya's four books are very popular and they are important, like Arthashastra, Chanakya Niti, Chanakya Sar Sangrah, and Chanakya Sutra. There are two great history books you can see on the screen, and numbers are two, and they are Valmiki Ramayana and Ved Vyas written the greatest book, the biggest book of the world, called Mahabharata, which has about 1,300,000 shlokas. There are three great story books in Sanskrit and they are embedded with subtler piece of knowledge and wisdom. Their names are Panchatantra, Kathasarit Sagar and Hitopdesha. Then there are various books by Adi Shankaracharya which one should refer. Their names are Tattva Bodh, Atma Bodh, Nirvana Shatakam, Bhaj Govindam, Aparokshanubhuti, Vakya Vritti, Dakshinamurti Stotram and Vivek Chudamani. These are very interesting books. Some books are basic grammar to understand Vedanta, for example, Tattva Bodha and Atma Bodha. And there are many other books by Adi Shankaracharya which are included in this list or may not be included in this list. They are very interesting reading for any person who is searching for pieces of wisdom. And lastly, I would like to mention here two books by Raman Maharshi. Both are in Sanskrit. One is Upadesh Sar and other is Saddarshanam. So deliberately, I showed some of the books on screen because they should be referred to time and again. And as we go back to scriptures time and again with enhanced wisdom at different point of time.
Sir, what are the main things you would like to highlight?
There are various things, and in this short discussion, I can just hint about that. For example, scriptures, they talk about how to manage self, how to manage relation with other, how to be effective in a situation when you are part of a team and you are deciding in a team situation, how to manage organization, how to manage society, how to manage nation, how to manage ecology, how to manage universe. So there are various issues which are available in Sanskrit scripture. In my own limited study, I am a humble student of this field. I have found 210 topics of management which can be directly addressed by the wisdom of Sanskrit scriptures. Other sets of knowledge which we find in Sanskrit scriptures, they can be said as knowledge related to functional area of management. For example, Sanskrit scripture talks about strategic management when it says that strategy of organization should be such that the main goal is always attended to, and one should never lose sight of the main goal. It is also said in Rig Veda that the way a butterfly sucks the honey of a flower without disturbing the beauty of flower, in the same way, any entrepreneur out of his or her own endeavor should get profit without destroying the beauty of the organization. Just these were some examples of how we should actually manage organizations. Then Shukraniti very aptly says about how to recruit people, how to train people, how to retain people. We claim these are modern themes, but Shukracharya long back was emphasizing on all these issues. Some issues which are not found in general literature of management are found in scriptures. For example, our modern literature in management says which organizations one should prefer to work. But seldom I have found that our modern literature talks about which are the conditions in which one should decide to leave an organization. Shukracharya even has very clearly said that if certain conditions are available all at a time, one should think about switching over from the organization. Scriptures talk about financial management also, how taxation should be there, how progressive taxation can lead to better payment of taxation, and how it can benefit society better. Then it also talks about marketing management. In Vidur Niti, which is part of Mahabharata, there are six strategies which have been discussed, that how actually a king should behave with the neighboring king. Similarly, if we actually can replicate those theories into marketing, we can apply it for managing competition in a healthy manner, that how we can actually address the competition, and if various products from competitors, they are rising, they are doing well, what strategies we should take. So scriptures, if you just go there, I can humbly say that tell me any issue of management, and it can be told after referring to scriptures, that what scriptures have to say about that. So it is very exhaustive.
Sir, what suggestions you would like to give for management teachers to develop theories, models based on Indian scriptures?
Well, management educationists, researchers and teachers, basically we work on research topics where variables are well defined. And I would like to invite all the academicians, if you are interested in searching for variables towards scriptures. For example, if I take a simple model called Sattvic, Rajasic, Tamasic model, and scriptures, they have list that which are the characteristics of a Sattvic personality vis-a-vis a Rajasic personality vis-a-vis a Tamasic personality. So scriptures, they are handy material to understand variables, and we can always go for sub-variables. We can create various kinds of instruments and questionnaires based on the variables available in scriptures. Scriptures, they are able to give you a model and framework also. For example, if we want to know what are the characteristics of a good leader, now scriptures may not be able to tell you just at one place in one scripture various characteristics of good leaders, but if we refer various scriptures and if we find in which different context, which king. King means the leader, and today the leader's meaning is different, but we can replicate the knowledge. We can replicate the knowledge, and if we combine all these sources at one place, we start getting some kind of flowchart or a model.
Sir, what could be possible reasons for growing interest in Indian ethos and culture in management?
Indian ethos and culture in management. Let me submit humbly that Indian ethos or Indian insight, we are not referring because we are born in India. It is my humble thinking that Indian wisdom actually is universal wisdom. And the custodian is geographical part of India. And because when civilization was in its nebulous state in many places, in the many geographies of the world, India had best literatures, for example, Upanishads. That's why interest of persons are increasing in Indian insight. Most of the management literature, they are addressing the issues of centrifugality. That is how we can be more dynamic outside, how we can be more dynamic with our competitors, but how to manage ourselves, because centripetal forces which are involved, unless we manage these centripetal forces, we cannot manage centrifugal forces. Whole world is getting torn apart. Society, family, organization, people are feeling bogged down. They are under a lot of pressures. And if we know how to manage well, we can do better. And including all the themes, scriptures have promised to contribute, but especially with respect to self-management, there is no other piece of literature which can compete with or which can be placed parallel with Indian scriptures.
Sir, please tell us from where the positive change with respect to ethos in management would create more impact through corporate and through academics, and why?
That is a very interesting question. Seed first or tree first? If there is no tree, there will be no seed. If there is no seed, there will be no tree. But I think both have to come in communion. We have to join hands. Corporates, they have to learn many things from academia. Academia, they have to learn many things from corporates. Yes, but I think seed is always with academia, because here we get students in their early ages, in their teen ages or in their early youth. When they go back to industry and they go back with the sanskara, what they learn from here. I would not like to rank, but still, if you force me to rank, I'll say academia first and corporate second. But without corporate applying all the ethics or values or morality, there is no use simply talking about these things in academia.
Sir, large number of researchers and teachers are not well acquainted with even basic knowledge of Sanskrit and Sanskriti. So in this backdrop, even if interested, how can they proceed?
One should not get afraid of Sanskrit. And Sanskrit scriptures are nowadays available with either English transliteration, with translation, or even translation in your own language. It can be Hindi. Scriptures are also available in any Indian languages nowadays. It may be Gurumukhi or Gujarati or Marathi or Telugu or Kannada or Tamil or Telugu, Bengali, Odia, Assami, any language you talk about, they are there. But yes, a question arises from where to start. So I'll suggest that if one has to start taking interest in Sanskrit scriptures, beginning can be with Bhagavad Gita, because Bhagavad Gita is in simpler form of Sanskrit. Upanishadic Sanskrit have their own inclination, a bit complex. So begin with Bhagavad Gita and then move towards Upanishad. And for many Upanishads nowadays, translation in your own vernacular language or Hindi or other languages are very much available. One thing I would like to say, that Sanskrit scriptures, they need certain empathy from your side also. Because there are two types of sweets, you know. Some sweets are juicy outside, juicy inside. But scriptures are juicy inside, but outside it is not so juicy. You have to put effort. You have to convince to scriptures that I am interested in you. Then scriptures will start revealing to you their own secret and fathomless wisdom they contain.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir, for the interesting discussion with us. Thank you.
Thank you very much.